Hello and welcome to Rajya Sabha Television with me, Frank Pereira. Jawaharlal Nehru University Chief Proctor, who is responsible for inquiry into all cases of indiscipline on the campus, has resigned from the post allegedly over differences with the administration. This is the second time that the Chief Proctor has resigned ever since the new Vice Chancellor took over in January 2016. Chief Proctor A.P. Dimri was leading several inquiries, including the alleged attack on 26-year-old Najib Ahmed, who has been missing from the campus since October 15, 2016. Of late, we've seen that the Premier Institute has been in the news for several wrong reasons. But what ails the university? That's what we're going to try and discuss on this edition of The Big Picture. Joining me on the program today are Professor Rajvir Sharma, RSS thinker, Professor Sukhadeo, Thorat, Chairman, Indian Council of Social Science Research, Professor Ravi Srivastava, School of Social Sciences, JNU, and N.R. Mohanty, Director, Jagran Institute of Management and Mass Communication. Thank you so much, gentlemen, for joining me on this edition of The Big Picture. Professor Thorat, I'd like to start with you, of course. What ails the university, the premier institute, JNU? Well, we seem to have lost the line there with Professor Thorat, but we'll try and reconnect with him. But in the meantime, Professor Srivastava, what are the problems really in JNU and who's causing these problems?
Well, the problems, there are problems in JNU, I have to admit that. We lost a student, Najib. We have not been able to find that student. The whole process by which people who have been penalized for, you know, creating a situation in which he disappeared is one which is surrounded with mystery. But I think the bigger issue here is that JNU has, from the very beginning, from its inception, has tried to internalize the goals for which Indian universities have been set. If you read the Radhakrishnan Committee report, if you read the Kothari Commission report, issues of social justice, democracy, constitutional values, Radhakrishnan Committee said the university is created basically to fulfill what is laid down in our preamble.
Of course, one of the objectives was also national integration.
National integration, democracy, social justice, and JNU, through its character, the nature of its admissions, the nature of the education that it imparts, has tried to imbibe that fully. Now, what the teachers in the university, what the student community in the university is finding over the last few months is that there seems to be a systematic assault on this basic character of JNU. The basic character of JNU, its inclusive character,
and
its
who's responsible character. For the systematic attack?
Well, I have to say that it's basically the administration which is responsible for it. Why the administration is acting in a particular way, in which one can also say in a partisan way, why is it that the administration is not coming to the negotiating table in an open way, discussing problems which can be sorted across the table? A number of these issues the administration can solve across the table, but this is not happening. One thing which has never happened in the history of JNU is that the administration is not the Raja and the students and teachers are not treated as the Praja. We are one. The Vice Chancellor naturally is only the first among the group of teachers who are there. He is not more qualified than many of the teachers in JNU. And there has always been this process of consultation between the teachers and the academic community.
Sure.
We suddenly find that the balls are being played, literally and figuratively, where the teachers and the communities are not being able to get across, communicate their viewpoint to the administration. The administration will not listen, or when it listens also will not be prepared to give and take, not prepared to negotiate. So nothing reaches a solution. Problems are built up, and it seems to us that these problems are leading to a situation where the inclusive character of JNU, the democratic character of JNU, the participative character of JNU is under assault. And I want to tell you one thing, that JNU's excellence is actually built on its democratic, inclusive and participative character. We don't take the best in the country, we take people from all parts of the country, from all walks of life, students who show potential. They are sons of agricultural laborers. They come from extremely deprived groups. And through three years or whatever, they are nurtured in JNU and they become first-rate citizens of this country.
who are then left-leaning is some of the people who criticize them.
Yes,
and say
of course,
that they are
the foreign secretary of this country, the CEO of Niti Aayog, the main advisors of the prime minister in the prime minister's office, and so many others, if you want to call them. And as you know, the JNU today has the largest numbers of members of parliament for any university in this country.
Sure, fair enough. Your
the
point
largest
taken.
Number of ministers.
Professor Srivastava, your point taken. I'm going to let Professor Sharma now counter what you're saying. Professor Sharma, would you agree with everything that Professor Srivastava has said?
I look at the things in a different way. And I believe that two things are being attempted in JNU by certain sections of teachers and students. One, the myth of assault on the basic character of JNU. There's no assault on the character of the JNU, but of course, if somebody tries the slogans of Bharat Tere Tukde Honge, Inshallah, Inshallah, Afzal Hum Sharminda Hain, Tere Katil Jinda Hain, if that is the culture of JNU, I'm sorry, that has never been to my mind, and perhaps the majority of the citizens of the country will agree that that was not the purpose and not
also the majority
never
the
complete, and it was
Professor Srivastava, he did not interrupt when you spoke. Let him complete and then I'll let you speak.
It was never the character of or the objectives of JNU. In fact, to me it appears that there is a problem of change, and whenever there is a change, it is really very difficult for certain people to digest it. And this is the basic, root that the kind of politicization too much and excessive intolerance of the two unions, teachers and the students. They have come together expressing some kind of intolerance, and this is because of that reason. Of course, there's no alternative to communication and a dialogue, but dialogue has to be with the people who come with an open mind and discuss, and they try to solve the problems of the university. That is not happening. Secondly, if you look at the problems of JNU in the last few months, I think there's a deliberate attempt on the part of certain sections in the teachers and in the students that either we or nobody. Rather, they are following the principle of only we and nobody. Now, if this is the principle of only we and nobody, where's the democracy? And if suppose there is some kind of a social justice is not the motive only of JNU. In fact, all higher educational institutions cannot and should not ignore the principles of social justice. And there are provisions for this. There are reservations in the admission system. And through that also we can induct people with poorer background or a lower background so as to impart some kind of a justice to the deprived sections, the exploited sections, which is a must in this country. Now, I do not know as to what else is the basis of inclusive system. Now, inclusive system is where every section of the society must get an opportunity and access to education and to also through the admission system. Is it being assaulted that the inclusion has been changed into exclusion? I don't think so. I don't have any example where people have been excluded deliberately from a certain system. So I think preconceived notions, prejudices, biases, this is the environment which is vitiating the total kind of a concept of a university.
Sure, fair enough. Your point taken as well. Now, I'm going to bring in Professor Thorat as well. Before, I know Professor Srivastava, you want to respond to that. I'm going to allow you to respond to that, but let me bring in the other panelists also into the debate. Professor Thorat, you know, as far as the university itself is concerned, do you believe that it has become a hostage of political setups?
That has cropped up in the JNU relates to the regulation of admission 2016. And there the UGC has mentioned that the admission to the MPhil PhD program should be through written examination and viva. And the I see a limitation or shortcoming of both UGC and JNU. I'll come to that both. Please allow me to have time. While UGC has mentioned that the admission should be through written exam and viva, it has not made it very clear that whether in the final selection, what proportion of written marks and what proportion of viva should be taken account. Number two, we are discussing about the social justice. The UGC regulation also does not spell that in the written examination, in the entrance examination, a 5% or 10% consideration should be given to the scheduled caste and scheduled tribe. So that will undermine the admission of scheduled caste and scheduled tribe. And third is, that the UGC has not made it clear that you cannot apply this law retrospectively. No, it never happened. So these are the limitations of the UGC regulation. Now, the way they have been accepted by JNU, there are several shortcomings. One is that JNU is making the entrance examination, eliminating the people at the level of the written examination with 50%, and then making the selection 100% on the basis of IBA. This is not the spirit of the UGC regulation, and this is a sheer mistake by the administration. No university 100% selection is made on the viva. Supreme Court doesn't allow that because there are a lot of biases in viva. See, that is the first thing that JNU has mistake that JNU has committed. Second thing I would like to add here that there has been a discussion in JNU that the percentage of viva should be reduced from 30% to 15%. I was the chairman of that committee. And in the light of that, when they want to reduce the percentage of viva because they suspect that the scheduled caste students have been subject to discrimination in viva, so they wanted to eliminate the viva altogether. On the contrary, now, here is a university which is making the selection completely 100%. Now, this is not a social justice as far as the scheduled caste is concerned. Now, the last point that I will mention and then stop is that the point that Ravi Srivastava has made too. All the changes in the admission policy and many things are discussed in JNU through consultation. Now, consultation means not the political process. There are in the bylaws and in the practices of the JNU that the decision is taken bottom up from the center in the school and then it goes to the executive council. The mind of the university teacher and the student is reflected in the final decision. Now, that is not being done in this particular case. Now, let me give and then I'll stop it here. For example, in 1984, a major policy change came in admission, the Bipin Chandra Committee. And they dropped two things. One is income criteria was dropped because the income was misused. And remember that Bipin Chandra was a left-oriented person. And he, despite that, he said no income criteria. Second, they dropped the viva OC examination for for MA. We had a written examination and viva for selection both at MA and MPhil level, but we dropped it at MA. So the drastic changes are made, but through an expert committee and common consultation and discussion. This time the changes in the admission policies, which are very serious nature, are being made without consultation and taking the common views of the student and the teacher. When we are saying that the JNU is a democratic institution, it is not on the street or in the demonstration. It is through the decision making by the center and the school and the university. And that has not happened. I have 3-4 suggestions at the end when I come.
Yeah, sure. I'll take your suggestions from you ahead in the program. But Professor Srivastava, do you want to respond to what Professor Sharma has said and what Professor Thorat has said before I get in and add Mohanty to the picture as well?
I think what Professor Sharma says, I'm glad that he accepts along with everybody else that our universities need to be socially inclusive. And then there is a policy framework for that. I just want to go beyond that and say that JNU over 40 years has evolved a particular policy of social and national inclusion, and that has met the test of time, that has evolved through consultations. Professor Thorat was referring to that. What has happened in the recent past is that these policies have been subverted, not only through that not enough consultation has taken place, but decisions have been taken in the name of the Academic Council. In other words, decisions which were actually not taken by the Academic Council have been presented by the administration as decisions of the Academic Council to the Executive Council for approval, but the details have not been worked out. You know, the details have not been presented. And it appears that if those decisions are implemented in the way that they have been approved, it will mean a huge setback for the social and the national composition of JNU's intake, as well as the overall intake. And here, as Professor Thorat said, there could be some issues in the 2016 regulation, But many of us believe that the biggest issue, set of issues, are in the way the administration has actually dealt with the issue and the way it has interpreted them. And these are issues which could be solved through face-to-face dialogue, but the dialogues have been converted into monologues because the administration is not willing to state its position and discuss them. So I think one thing I would strongly disagree with, the Professor Sharma says that we don't want dialogue, that the teachers want dialogue. This is absolutely incorrect. The teachers want dialogue. They want to settle things in the way. But now the teachers in JNU are being treated as basically, as I said, praja. The administration is the Raja. It issues diktats. It issues, you know, disciplinary notices to teachers, and we have to take it. We have to take every diktat that is issued, irrespective of the way those decisions have been reached. So I think this situation is serious. Administration does need to understand that JNU has given a lot to the country.
Sure.
In the sense, many universities have imbibed this process, and they have furthered the objective to which Mr. Sharma was referring to. Please look at it concretely, the kind of intake that we have and the people who have come out of that intake.
Indeed. Mr. Mohanty, let me bring you into the debate right now, because, you know, we've heard all the other panelists but haven't heard you. You know, my question that I posed earlier about, you know, political setups taking the university hostage, that wasn't answered by Professor Thorat. Do you want to add something to that? You know, have political parties really taken the system hostage there at JNU?
Yeah, I sincerely believe JNU has been hostess to political ideology right from the days of its inception. You look at today, the contrasting picture is that BJP, RSS are in power and directly controlling the setup. And they have their exclusive ideology, which the JNU vice chancellor is representing today. In the 70s, it was Indira Gandhi who was the prime minister. She was that time taking the support of the CPI. So she was not a left ideologically, but the liberal left certainly dominated during her administration because of the close association. And because Nurul Hasan was the education minister, JNU was set up, all the prominent left intellectuals across the country were brought into JNU. And that certainly gave a good character to JNU. JNU was a hub of intellectual activity which attracted students like us from all over the country. But the fact is that since it was a left-liberal setup, obviously that voice dominated. Other voices were extremely silent, or whenever that erupted, they obviously did not find any voice at all. And that's why, because the other forces like ABBP, NSUI, all these parties were completely stillborn. They had absolutely no, virtually no existence at all. And that's the time when some of us said it's a paradoxical situation in JNU when you are asking for freedom. But when Soviet Union attacks Afghanistan, you are justifying that attack, then that's certainly not a very, very happy situation. We as students want to demonstrate our loyalty and commitment to democratic ideals. But when democracy is being crushed, we are defending that regime. That's what we raised that question. That's why we felt that... And I must say that time, largely the JNU faculty, which had a lot of left intellectuals, we had very few non-left teachers that time, they all had turned hostile to us. We were ideologically with the left. And I certainly liked that the JNU left had created an ambience where debate and dialogue was possible. And that's why we debated. And that's why we had all-night debates and discussions in which we convinced the students why our position is right, why SFI's and ASF's positions were wrong. And that's why they gave us an overwhelming mandate. I became president of JNU Students Union. And our council got a great majority in that. That was the democratic process which left had originated and which left had
not. Is that democratic process still there?
That democratic process in the student elections, it's still there.
Mm.
But today, the conflict between, what has happened? That time, the administration was liberal left, faculty, teachers association was liberal left, students were liberal left. So there was absolute synchronization.
So the process today, was streamlined, but today things are different.
Today, the top-notch position is not liberal left, anti-liberal left, and that's why the conflict has come up. Teachers continue to be liberal left, and students largely continue to be liberal left, but the administration is ultra-radical right.
Sure. Okay, Professor Sharma, the liberal left voices, as Mr. Mohanty is suggesting, you know, have dominated the discourse at JNU over the last 40 years. Now it is time for the right extremist groups to take that space and come into the university. Is that what's happening?
No, I think I agree with Dr. Mohanty for the fact that JNU from the very beginning has been a place where a certain ideology, that is what he called liberal, though I don't say anything liberal in left, at least a liberal ideology, a left ideology and a left idea was dominating the entire scene. And as he rightly said, that there was no space for the other side to have its way or say, if not way. But presently what happens is that now it is a clash of ideas. It's a clash of certain approaches that you have to provide a space to all people, right, left, center.
Professor, would you concede that the right is trying to make its own space in JNU?
No, actually, it is not now. ABVP has been there in JNU for quite a long time. Though they were suppressed, the voices were suppressed, they were not allowed to express themselves, but perhaps now they are getting some kind of space. And that is why the left is now not able to see that this space must be granted to the non-left voices. I think that is the crux, that is the root of the conflict.
Sure.
That is going
sure.
on.
Sure. Professor Thorat, you wanted to speak about some suggestions and the way forward. What is the... Okay, we still don't have Professor Thorat at the moment, but, you know, Professor Srivastava, as far as some of the issues that were raised, one of them, you know, a serious charge about, you know, harboring separatist elements within JNU. What do you have to say about that?
Well, you know, there's been a process of inquiry, both from within the university, but also, you know, the police has been carrying out an inquiry. If indeed terrorists or any other anti-national elements have been harbored, the Teachers Association's position from day one, absolute day one, has been that there should be punishment should be meted out, the law should take its own course, and we condemned the incidents that took place in February. We condemned them, whoever was responsible, we are not an inquiry committee, but we condemned them outright. We also condemned the way the vitiated process through which the subsequent inquiry was carried out by the administration and the police. And as you know, till date, this is 1 year now, that not even a charge sheet has been filed against Kanhaiya Kumar. He was, you know, all kinds of things were heaped upon him. He went to jail. So we have taken, in my view, we took a fairly non-partisan stand. Even on the development, subsequent developments, our argument is not that, you know, this should happen or that should happen. Yes, we stand up for the way JNU policies have developed in the matter of admission, in the matter of selections, and so on and so forth. We believe that we are a higher education institution. And we need to have autonomy. And the UGC in the past has also given us that autonomy and space to develop ourselves. Now, at present, the administration is usurping a whole number of powers. The academy, even the statutory committees are not being able to perform their role. And this is a serious issue.
Sure.
And I think the space should be open for diaspora. We are all for dialogue. And I believe that if dialogue is held between the teachers, students, the administration, and the University Grants Commission, we can certainly, you know, find a solution within
indeed,
the framework.
Indeed.
The administration has to demonstrate its will to find a solution.
Indeed. I know, Professor Sharma, you want to make a point. I'll just allow you to make that point. But before that, Mr. Mohanty, you know, as far as autonomy is concerned, you know, Professor Srivastava is talking about autonomy. Do you believe that somewhere down the line, the government has been too liberal with JNU and its functioning, and, you know, now suddenly to bring it, you know, to try and curb it is going to be difficult? And that's what's happening right now.
No, that's the way JNU function, the way the university ought to function.
Yes, absolutely.
University should be an area where 1,000 conflicting ideas should contend and bloom. And I feel that JNU certainly allowed. Professor Sharma said about ABBP, when I was also a student, ABBP and SUA, they were there. But unfortunately, they did not succeed in creating a larger base.
Hmm.
But over a period of time, when they did, one NSUI president happened, even ABBP also elected a president of JNU Students Union. So even if so-called left liberal students as well, they voted when there was a good candidate on ABBP platform, he was elected. When there was a good candidate on NSUI platform, he was also elected.
Yes.
So JNU had all kinds of, I was on a Students for Democratic Socialism, SDS. Platform, which was a new organization we built with local, regional, campus-based organization. On that, I got elected.
Sure.
So that way, there was a certain kind of an autonomy about the dialogue that was there. And today, but the vice chancellor should have a certain degree of autonomy. I would give you one example. We had a vice chancellor called Professor Naidumma, C. Naidumma or something. And I remember we were doing some agitation, doing a hunger strike and on some issue. And that suddenly the vice chancellor just alone watched down, sits in the midst of us.
Hmm.
Tell me, what are your issues? We heard that. And in 15 minutes flat, the issues were resolved.
Sure. Discussion and debate is the way forward is what you're saying. Professor Thorat, you know, you spoke about some suggestions and you said that you have four suggestions to give. Could you please go ahead and share your suggestions as to how the situation can be improved?
No, as far as this question of admission policy is concerned, I have four suggestions. That the Vice Chancellor should keep this decision on hold. Set up a committee and let the committee go into the entire issue, taking the UGC rules into consideration and the practices and that the JNU has developed. Because I believe that the UGC regulation only suggests written examination, viva, as a precondition for admission. It doesn't suggest that how much mark of the written examination and how much mark of viva should be taken. That is left to the university to a greater extent. And there the JNU should form their own opinion through an expert committee. And then place the suggestion of the committee in the public domain, student, the teacher, get the views of the center and the school, and then develop a collective opinion on that. That can be accepted by the EC or EC. There is no undermining of the power of the Vice Chancellor. Vice Chancellor is the protector of the ordinances and regulation.
Sure.
But the decision has to come from the down, and they should be taken in accordance with the rules and regulation. And the second thing is that whatever policy is then finally decided, they should be legally vetted. I think that is what the approach of the JNU has been, that everything has been discussed through discussion, and whatever is ultimately accepted is the mind of the university teacher and the student, and that is why it became a lot more effective and successful university.
Indeed.
I just want to make one point.
Yeah, very quickly, because I'm running out of time. Very quickly.
Just quickly. I'm a little surprised over the student union is being dominated by the left. Shall we say that Delhi University is dominated by the non-left for last 30, 40, 50 years? So should we say that there we don't have a comfort?
Okay, fair enough. Point taken. Professor Sharma, please, very, very short final comment from you.
There is a need. I mean, nobody questions the fact that there should be a need, autonomy of the university intact. But at the same time, there's a need for providing a space to all kind of ideas. That is what will solve the problems.
Indeed. All right. On that note, I'll have to call it a wrap on this edition of The Big Picture. Professor Rajvir Sharma, Professor Sukhadeo Thorat, Professor Ravi Srivastava, and Dr. N.R. Mohanty, thank you so much, gentlemen, for joining me on the program and putting things into perspective for us. That's all the time we have. Thank you so much for watching.